Professor M.G.K. Menon. He's a well-known cosmic ray physicist who has been involved in experiments ranging from balloon flights to the deepest mines. He was involved in the experiment at Kola Goldfields, which set limits on the lifetime of the proton and on the existence of magnetic monopoles. Professor Menon has been instrumental in formulating the science policies of India and nurturing scientific institutions. We look forward to hearing him talk on nurture, nature, and ambience in scientific discovery.
Good morning, everyone. I took the invitation from Ravi Subramanian rather literally, which is that he wanted a symposium on radicals in science, nature or nurture. So that's what I will be talking about. And there will be a shift of gear from the wonderful presentation we had from Michael Berry. Technical, with slides, and I don't have any transparencies or of the type which he described, which are projected on these flat, big objects which you have in lecture halls. And I'm glad, though, that so many people have not taken Ravi seriously. And because of that, since I came yesterday, I've had the opportunity of listening to some wonderful talks by Shaver, Bob Frater, and now Michael Berry. And all I can say, I'll come to some of those other points a little later, is that the talk given by Michael Berry is something that would have gladdened the heart of the founder of this institute. No question about it. If he was here, he would be jumping around, because that was the way he was. Anyway, this is to celebrate an occasion. And the occasion is the great event that we are going to celebrate tonight, which is RADS crossing this magical figure which Ravi had described, which we all talk of in terms of moons past. So I will start on that particular topic. Of course, Chairman has very kindly introduced me in terms of my background of cosmic ray physics. But that I will leave to my distinguished colleague, Srikantan, who will be talking about that field a little later. So I will be talking about nature and nurture, and the Indian experience particularly. There will be other instances also. I'd like to start with RAD as a radical in science. And the reason I mention that is because I have been to this institute many, many times when the founder was here, C.V. Raman. Of course, as you know, I think everybody realizes that he was nature. He was himself. He's not the product of anybody. Though greatly influenced by several books that he had read, and without question, in physics, one of his great heroes was the person behind this whole field of waves, Lord Rayleigh. And he used to talk in glowing terms about Rayleigh. Of course, he was, as we say, a product of nature, not of nurture. But he nurtured much more from that starting point. And I think we have to recognize that there are starting points anywhere, and from there flows the rest of the stream. Of course, from the great school that he established in Kolkata, where he discovered the Raman effect and won the Nobel Prize and so on, Indian Association for Cultivation of Science. And there are many great names associated with that period and thereafter through his life. We have, of course, people who worked specifically in that area which he was in optics, wave theory, crystallography and the like. But there are many who branched out elsewhere. One, of course, thinks of people like K.S. Krishnan, K.R. Ramanathan, S.P. Venkateshwaran, Nagendranath, Ramdas, a whole lot of people. But K.R. Ramanathan, for instance, went off to a completely different field of atmospheric sciences and ionospheric physics, on which he was, in that field, he was a doyen. It was then, from Kolkata, he came to Bangalore. This is not a talk on C.V. Raman per se. I have given that and the whole question of this institute a few years ago when we were celebrating the jubilee of this institute and in a colloquium. But of course in Bangalore, and very few people recognize this, he encouraged two complete fields to emerge which are not his. And that was through two individuals whom he nurtured. One was Homi Bhabha, for whom he found a place here. Homi Bhabha had already been nurtured in Cambridge. From there, after establishing a great reputation in theoretical physics, and his hero was another person who didn't nurture anybody, but to whom he looked up to, Paul Dirac. Homi Bhabha was here on a vacation. War broke out. He could not go back to Cambridge. So he stayed on. And it was C.V. Raman, the founder of this institute, who found him a place at the Indian Institute of Science. And indeed proposed him for the fellowship of the Royal Society. It was in fact a relationship between them. Which was very important for development of science in India. And I won't also give a talk on Homi Bhabha, but one must remember that he set up the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, which he called the cradle of India's atomic energy program, and went on to develop the whole atomic energy program that we have today. I'm not talking of other individuals in science whom C.V. Raman nurtured. I'm talking of those who did other things. Amongst them was a young student, Vikram Sarabhai. And Vikram Sarabhai was a student here under C.V. Raman. So there was a generation gap. C.V. Raman, 1888. Homi Bhabha, 1909. Vikram Sarabhai, 1917. And the two of them, Homi Bhabha and Vikram Sarabhai, got going like a house on fire. And he was the one who started and developed the whole Indian space program, envisioned it. I'm just showing the connectivity which goes on in fields which may be completely different from your own. Those were two. There was, of course, a great crystallographer, G.N. Ramachandran, who was a product of that period. And I won't describe to you the details of all that he did, including the triple helical structure of collagen and so on. Ramachandran plot. Many things in crystallography. But C.V. Raman created these people. And then, when he had to leave the Indian Institute of Science, he set up what is really for himself, in the last phase of his life, a haven. And that's what this is. As we call in this country, an ashram. In the forest, and that's what he created around here. And he had good science done here. I will only name a few. There was A.K. Ramdas. There was Sivaramakrishnan Chandrasekhar. There was Jayaraman. And most of all, the person that Michael Berry talked about, Pancharatnam, who was a favorite of his. So he did all this. In this Raman Research Institute. And then he departed. After that, two of us, Sivaraj Ramasheshan and I, came here to see what we should do about the Raman Research Institute. We are both members of the trust, the Raman Research Institute Trust, to which all this belonged, the land, buildings, and whatever you wanted to do with it. What did we encounter? We came here. There was a driver, there's a gardener, there's a laboratory attendant. No scientists, no programs, nothing. So the first responsibility was to find somebody who would create it, who would nurture it. And Sivaraj Ramaseshan had already talked to Sir C.V. Raman. I won't go through the story of that, those discussions of that period towards the end of his life. And Sivaraj then told me that the person we have to get here is Radha Krishna. I said, you go ahead, write to him, persuade him, see if he will come here. I will do the rest of it to make sure that his coming is worthwhile. Now, I will not be speaking this evening, but I would like to wish Rad all the very best on this occasion. It's a great conference. And we had old buddies of his here to wish him well. Some like me of his age. So what happened? He was a product of nature, first, if you look at his pedigree. But he was a free individual, a free radical, who decided to do things on his own. Was in Sweden, and then was nurtured at two of the great centers in the world. One was Caltech and the other was the whole group in Australia, which I will talk about in a few moments. From there, we had to pull him out, to bring him back here. That was the task that Sivaraj accomplished, and I must give him all the credit for it. So you can see that here was this institute, this building, and this lecture hall, where Professor Raman used to give the Gandhi Memorial Lecture, and I've listened to him many times in this hall. But there was no science around, none whatsoever. And today what we have is a very large number of people, of students particularly, in a variety of fields, in radio astronomy, in light and matter physics, in condensed matter physics, in theoretical areas, particularly of the nature that Michael Berry talked about, gravitational physics and the like. All this is what you see here today, but it had a starting point. The first starting point was Professor Sir C. V. Raman, who created it, who nurtured many others. The second starting point was RAD. And not only this conference, but this institution and the people around, the interdisciplinarity of work here, is the best tribute we can pay him. So that is how he nurtured what was the institute and what is today the institute. There were some conditionalities, and fortunately we had a leadership in this country at the level of the Prime Minister of India who were willing to accept all conditionalities, give it the autonomy and freedom to function, which is very important. And I'll come to that in a moment. That's the last point in my talk that I have listed, the ambience. Because very often the question is asked, why is it in this country we have these nucleating points, and we have had many. I mentioned about C.V. Raman. If there was a genius, it was that mathematician, Srinivas Ramanujan. One did not expect him to generate a school. But there are others. Jagdish Chandra Bose. And the great work he did, particularly the discovery, the generation, the transmission, detection of millimeter wave phenomena. There was, not in the same class, Prashanta Chandra Mahalanobis, who created an institution. I happen to be the president of that. But I know that it does not have the standing today that it had in his day. And I also know all that Homi Bhabha did. Science has become certainly very different from what it was in those days. But on the other hand, we have to ask ourselves a very serious question. What prevents us from developing and growing, proceeding along the pathway that was set by the people who nucleated these centers? There are some which are doing well. This institute is doing well. The Tata Institute is doing well, fundamental research. The Atomic Energy Program is doing reasonably well. The Space Program, particularly with the leadership it has had since then, of somebody here who is a great admirer of C.V. Raman, Satish Dhawan, has done extremely well. And so on. So I won't describe it in great detail. But there are many other institutions which have not grown in the same way. And one of the questions we have to ask ourselves is, what prevents this happening? There is in Munich, the Deutsche Museum. And it has a magnificent display of not genetic genealogy, but what we call in this country the Guru Shishya Parampara, the relationship from a teacher to a student, from a guru to a shishya. And I will read out to you a little bit of what some of the people have said, because I have been pondering over this question on what one needs to do to grow science in this country in a continuity. And I think there are some indicators, but first and foremost, in the autobiographies of great scientists, one repeatedly comes across phrases which trace their own achievements to the influence of outstanding teachers. For example, Liebig was a pupil of the great French chemist Gay-Lussac, the discoverer of some of the fundamental laws of the behavior of gases. Gay-Lussac was in turn a pupil of Berthollet. Liebig has remarked, "The course of my whole life was determined by the fact that Gay-Lussac accepted me in his laboratory as a collaborator and a pupil." Liebig in turn told his student Kekulé, who then became famous for the benzene ring, about what he should be doing. From Liebig, one can trace successive generations of scientists containing more than 60 exceptionally distinguished names, including 30 Nobel laureates. The genealogy of 17 Nobel laureates are part of a teacher-pupil family descended from von Baer. One of these was Otto Warburg, who has remarked, "The most important event in the career of a young scientist is the personal contact with the great scientists of his time." Such an event happened to me in my life when Emil Fischer accepted me in 1903 as a co-worker in protein chemistry. Warburg's student was Hans Krebs, who also won a Nobel Prize, and has remarked, I quote, "If I ask myself how it came about that one day I found myself in Stockholm, I have not the slightest doubt that I owe this good fortune the circumstances that I had an outstanding teacher at the critical stage of my scientific career. He set an example in the methods and qualities of first-rate research. Distinction develops if nurtured by distinction." So therefore, we have to understand the importance of this nurturing process. There is also the question of an ambience. Homi Bhabha had said, when he set up the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, It is the duty of people like us to stay in our own country and build up schools of research such as some other countries are fortunate to possess, and to build up in time an intellectual atmosphere approaching what we knew in Cambridge, Paris, Göttingen, and this would have an electrifying effect on the development of science in India. That is what we are trying to do. There is an important aspect of the talks given here. I was delighted to have the opportunity of meeting Bob Fraiter, because only recently I was going through the details of one of the greatest technological inventions in which he had played a very crucial role. It was he who brought back John O'Sullivan from the Netherlands, asked him to come back to Australia, and then put him on use of techniques developed in radio astronomy for medical purposes. But John O'Sullivan went in another direction, fast Fourier transforms in radio signals. And I won't go through the details of that. Here is the person right in front of you who is the expert on the subject. But from that resulted one of the greatest inventions that one uses of, makes use of, each day in one's life. Just as much as CERN, the vast number of detector systems operational there, and the vast millions of bits of information that keep coming from them, from bubble chambers, from spark chambers, from counters, and all sorts of things. And from that, there was one person, Tim Berners-Lee, who was able to produce what is referred to today as the World Wide Web, which made internet something which is commonplace for use. In a similar sense, we today have anywhere the Wi-Fi system, where there is no wired communication between computers or computing systems, but can all be done on a mobile radio basis. That is the great discovery for which CSIRO and Australia have given the world. So it's a great privilege and a pleasure to see people like Bob Fraiter here. And I was delighted to hear the lectures given so far in this symposium, which are not related directly to nature or nurture, but illustrate the points involved. I ask myself, we have enough brilliant people, but we have to identify them. And they have to be identified by the brilliant people themselves. It is not that we have not had this particular attitude. one of C.V. Raman's favorite books related to Siddhartha, Gautama the Buddha, Fitzgerald's. And I would like to read to you a quotation of 2,500 years ago from Gautama the Buddha. And he said, and this is in total contrast with what happens in the country today, believe nothing merely because you have been told it or because it is traditional or because you yourself have imagined it. Do not believe what your teacher tells you merely out of respect for your teacher, but whatever after due examination and analysis, that doctrine believe and cling to and take it as your guide. This is what we do not do in this country today. We go by the general principle of who all the time. I was interested in some aspects of what is creativity, about which I have written earlier. And amusingly, there are three great geniuses in mathematics. One was Poincaré, the other was Gauss, and the third, Srinivas Ramanujam from India. Let me just read out to you what Poincaré was talking about. New ideas often come to those who have been constantly thinking and struggling with a problem. Poincaré had said, most striking at first is this appearance of sudden illumination, a manifest sign of long, unconscious prior work. The role of this unconscious work in mathematical innovation appears to be incontestable. And he gave a striking example from his own experience. He said, one evening, contrary to my custom, I drank black coffee and could not sleep. Ideas rose in crowds. I felt them collide until pairs interlocked, so to speak, making a stable combination. And this related to one of Poincaré's greatest discoveries, the theory of Fuchsian groups and Fuchsian functions, and arithmetic transformation of indefinite ternary quadratic forms. In a similar sense, Gauss has remarked, finally 2 days ago I succeeded, not on account of in my painful efforts, but by the grace of God. I'm leading you from there to Ramanujan. Like a sudden flash of lightning, the riddle happened to be solved. So there he attributes it to the grace of God. Ramanujam often wrote down his theorem in the morning, and he exclaimed that the goddess of Namakkal, the goddess of learning, the family deity, had inspired him with the proofs in his dreams. So here you see the manner in which nature works. But what is most important for the largest number is the process whereby from there onwards one has a process of nurture. And this is the nurturing that we are talking about. one of a great scientist, Jacques Monod, had remarked about the atmosphere in Caltech when he said he had gone there on a Rockefeller fellowship to work in the laboratory of Morgan. And then he remarked about and read out to you what he said. He wrote himself, "This was a revelation to me, a revelation of what a group of scientists could be like when engaged in creative activity and sharing it in constant exchange of ideas, bold speculations and strong criticism." That was what Caltech was and is. That is what CSIRO is. That is what Cambridge started. In fact, they moved from the days of J.J. Thomson to the days of Rutherford, to the days of Lawrence Bragg. And they moved into completely different areas. From an area like nuclear physics. And in Rutherford's days, there was a Nobel Prize every year. That happened then later in molecular biology, in the MRC laboratories. The nucleating point was himself, Lawrence Bragg, crystallography. But there was a person in biological crystallography, Max Perutz. And then it went on, down the line. And so, one has these schools which have continuously grown and developed up to today's period, when only last year, from that laboratory, Venki Ramakrishnan won a Nobel Prize in chemistry for the work on the ribosome. So it is important that we do not only nurture individuals, that's very important. They become the nucleating points beyond, but also nurture groups and programs which enable things to flower. And that is the responsibility of some of us who function at policy level. So I just wanted to say that not only is nature important, but we have a lot of that in this country. But nurture is important, which has also been done and demonstrated in this country, but not so much of institutions and large groups. One of those who did it was Homi Bhabha. Another who did it in recent times was Vikram Sarabhai. And they have developed programs which have ongoing capabilities. We have to do that also in science. So I hope that this whole program which we have before us on nature and nurture will continue to flower, both because we have the capabilities in terms of nature. We have also the capabilities to be nurtured, but we need to have the spirit and attitude which was stated 2,500 years ago by Gautama the Buddha. We cannot afford to continue with the attitudes that are here today. And I had remarked on this and once upon a time, some 30 years ago, under the banner of equality and democracy, circumstances operate powerfully against the development of excellence in science. I fear we have too much of equality and too little of promotion of excellence. It is the primary responsibility of the scientific community, which must recognize excellence as something precious, which requires the same effort in the community to cultivate and nurture, not something to be destroyed through envy and jealousy for petty considerations of individuals and groups. This was in the presidential address I gave for the Indian Science Congress, not far from here in Mysore in 1982. So with that, I will conclude and say it's been such a great pleasure to be here, to wish my good friend Rad all the very best as we move into the future. Good sailing. That's what is, I think, really characterizes him. Because what he loves most is to do the things he wants to do, flying, sailing, be free as a bird, be free as a fish. Keep it up. Thank you.
Country. If you think that we have progressed from life in villages, life in states, life in countries, and I now like to think life in an international community which worldwide is struggling to maintain the scientific independence of which you talked. So wouldn't it be better to aspire to stay in this international family of organizations which aspire to do excellence in science in the way you described, rather than making it nationalistic?
I am not in favor of nationalism per se. Certainly, somebody like Rad is a product of Caltech and of CSIRO. And that's where we brought him. But you can see the impact of his coming here as a nucleating point to nurture a whole institution, which is very important because it is some of these people who will go back. And we have programs today where one is part of the projects which Australia, United States, Netherlands and so on are running. And I don't have to go into the details of these. So it is not that I am advocating a nationalistic attitude. But there is an enormous base for science in this country, a huge number of people. We have over 1,000 million people. And therefore, if we encourage, you'll get many more C.V. Ramans, Ramanujans, Babas, J.C. Boses, and so on and so forth. And as a result of that, the world would benefit. So it is not that one is really requiring them for the purpose of nationalism, but for purposes of nucleating the process of nurture that they can be involved in.
Thank you very much also for your wonderful talk. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, okay. A number of the top groups which you mentioned just at the end of your talk, where you have this fantastic continuity of schools, are all in universities. Caltech is a university, Cambridge is a university, Göttingen was a university. In my country, all the top research is being done in universities. We do have institutes next to universities, like ASTRON and our Space Research Institute, but they're very closely connected to the university system. Now, of course, you also have fantastic institutes like this one and the Tata Institute, and what you mentioned, CSIRO, are very nice, fantastic things are being developed. But what I notice in this country, that the top science is all done in these institutes outside of universities. And I would think it would be extremely important that you also would create absolute top groups in your university system. And what's your opinion about this stuff?
You're absolutely right that we have to encourage and develop university systems. But I went on to read that last point, which I was hesitating in a certain sense, which I had talked about in the Science Congress in 1982 in Mysore, which is that many of our universities suffer from themselves. And we can go into a detailed discussion on that. But they do not encourage and nurture what they should be doing. So you mentioned Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. Homi Bhabha was invited by the Bombay University to be a professor there. And he said, I'm coming to Bombay. I'm going to set up an institute there. It will be part of Bombay University. And throughout the period I was there, I was a member of the Board of Studies, the Academic Council, the Senate and Syndicate of Bombay University. TIFR was a constituent affiliated institution of Bombay University, which London University is a large affiliating structure. It has many colleges. And therefore, the people from TIFR were meant to give lectures at the Bombay University. And in fact, there is today a small program supported by the Department of Atomic Energy of setting up a center for basic sciences which operates jointly by the Bombay University and the Department of Atomic Energy. So there are many things of this nature. We are trying new experiments, but because the classical universities, state and central, are their own enemies. That's part of, I mean, we can discuss it in detail, but I can tell you why it is so.
Professor Menon, and thank you very much for a very lucid lecture, and with your vast experience, you outlined the problems and also the possibilities. But the last question, I think, was a very pertinent question. Prior to independence, the best research in India was done in the universities. Then, instead of creating them and encouraging them further, I think they're allowed to run down as these new institutions came up, whether it's space or atomic energy or defense and so on and so forth. I feel even though now noises are made about reinvigorating the universities, not enough is being done. Of course, we can condemn them, saying they have themselves responsible for the state they are in. And what bothers me is that these institutions outside the university system now are reinventing themselves as universities, because after some time this complaint cannot come, because there will be Homi Bhabha University, there will be Vikram Sarabhai University, there will be some other university, though they are not university in the classical sense. So the question is, do we want university in the classical sense or not?
Well, we can have a Raghunathan, yeah. We can have a very detailed discussion on that. Right. But I will only give you two illustrations. One is, take the way the Madras University treated one of the greatest scientists of this country of that time, G.N. Ramachandran. You just look at that. And therefore, he had to leave. Because we don't have the vice chancellors of the class of Ashutosh Mukherjee of Kolkata, who picked up C.V. Raman, made him a Palit professor, straight away. No advertisements, no interviews, nothing, just an offer. Or like the great Lakshman Sai Mudaliar of Madras University. So there are many instances of this nature that I can describe too. Therefore, I wrote that, which I read out to you. But there are other things that we have to do today, which we have done and are continuing to do. In fact, the setting up of the ICERS, the setting up of the IITs are all part of the same, because they are all university-like structures. But we can discuss it in greater detail.